first of all, thanks to the organizer for the opportunity to show here my current work. The title of my talk is on the stability and scalar perturbation brought in non-local extended gravity theory, which is a collaboration with Álvaro de la Cruz Domínguez and José Pedro Mimoso. The outline of my talk is as follows. Firstly, I will speak about a brief introduction about the motivation, about a non-local theory. Later, I will speak about the local representation of this kind of theory. This is very important because our purpose is to study perturbation in this kind of theory. But this is very difficult to apply this in the non-local representation. So the point two is that we have the purpose to build a local representation of this theory in which we can apply perturbation. And finally, I will go with the conclusion. So, okay, let's go with the introduction. I think it's not necessary in this context to explain why we need a new theory of gravity modification about general relativity. So I want to focus on why a non-local theory of gravity. Well, for me, there are three main reasons. One is, well, if we let to introduce a non-local term, of course, we can introduce more possible terms. We have more freedom. Besides, in the context of quantum gravity, it's very useful to find effective energy momentum tensors. And in this sense, it is possible to introduce this kind of term. Besides, finally, the last motivation, the other one, is that it's possible to obtain a new phenomenology without a post-programmatic stability. This is very important because, like probably you know, when we introduce higher derivative in an axiom, this instability appears. So, okay, now we want to show you this axiom. This is the non-local axiom we want to study, where we have introduced the non-local part, the non-local interaction with this function of theta, which argument is the inverse of the Lambert term applied about the scalar of curvature, about R. Of course, if you put this function equal to zero, we obtain general relativity. But why this theory? Well, really there are two main reasons. One is that when we introduce this term, in some sense we are introducing we can obtain an accelerated universe, and in this sense we can avoid the need of an unnatural cosmological constant. Besides, with this kind of term, the start point of this acceleration appear when the structure with the formation of the structure. So in this sense, we can resolve the coincidence problem. This is the principal reason to introduce this axiom. But like I said before, it's very difficult to introduce perturbation with this representation of the theory. For this reason, we are going with the second point, a local representation of this theory. Well, really, this is very easy because, well, we only introduce a Lagrange multiplier, and of course, we redefine the field. Really, this is very easy because it's very typical in modified gravity to introduce this Lagrange multiplier, and in this sense, we will obtain this new action. Okay, so now, in principle, we have an equivalent axiom, an equivalent theory, but in the local representation. But in this point, we have the question if this is actually true. Well, if we want to tell if two theories are the same, the easiest to do this is to tell the equation of motion. If we have an action with one equation of motion and other action with other equation of motion, and both equation of motion are the same, of course, the motion of both systems are the same, and in this sense, both action reproduce the same system. So what we are going to focus on the equation of motion. In the local representation, you can see that we have the Lambertian in the right hand. Okay. On the other hand, in the non-local representation, we have the Lambertian in the left hand. The left hand. In principle, they see the same equation. Well, they have passed the Lambertian, but they see the same equation. But this is not true, because when we apply this, we have introduced a new degree of freedom. Because here, this solution of here is solution of this equation, but is not solution in this case. This is very important, because in this sense, we have introduced a new degree of freedom in the local representation, which is not in the non-local representation. Besides, it has another consequence, which is that the non-local representation is stable, and the local representation is unstable. This instability start of this mid degree of freedom. So, okay, then what is the problem? The problem is that when we apply this transformation, we introduce new solutions, and maybe some of these solutions could be unstable. So, I repeat this because I think it's the most important. In the non-local representation, we have many solutions. And in the local representation, we have another solution. Many of these solutions are solutions of the non-local representation, but there are two other solutions of the local representation which are not solutions of the non-local representation. So the most important here in this slide is to demonstrate that at the end of the day, we have to check if the solution that we find out in the local representation, they are in the non-local representation. This is very important, because if they are not, we are studying another theory. Okay? Like I say, when we are in the local representation, this representation could be unstable, and we have to perform two conditions in order to verify that the theory is stable. However, remember, we could have a stable solution which are not in the non-local theory. But if the solution is unstable, of course, they are not in the non-local representation. So, okay, you can see this is one of the conditions, and this is the other one. Now, I want to show you very briefly the background equation of this theory. Well, of course, you can apply variation with respect to the metric and variation with respect to the fields. And in this case, we take Friedman, Lemaître, Robertson, Walker for the metric, and we apply this in conformal time. So we obtain these four equations. I want to speak now about two examples of this function which are very studied in the literature. The first one is this of here. This is a very important example because, well, it's studied by many people who, well, they defend this function because with this function we can reproduce the lambda CDM history. But this has a big problem that, in general, this function is unstable. When we introduce this function in our system of equation and we study the conditions the previous condition, we can tell that they are not valid. So this function can reproduce the lambda CVM history, okay, this is perfect, but this function is unstable, and therefore the solution that we obtain with this function are not in the non-local theory. And this is the most important. For this reason, now we are to study this function, which is studied by many people too, like such as, for example, Sergei Avintsov. This is very important because, for example, here we are introduced two free parameters, which are f and b. In this sense, we have tried to fit these two parameters on one hand to reproduce a stable theory, and on the other hand to reproduce the observation with supernova et al. So we have with this function three problems. One is the problem of the bus, like I say. The other one is fitting to supernova data, and the last one is that for many values of these of these three parameters, we have an uncomputable system. This is very important because, of course, we want to resolve this with any program, and if our system is uncomputable, we can resolve. So, okay, let's go with the main part of our work, which is the perturbation in this kind of theory. I want to speak to very briefly about the quasi-static approximation. This is approximation in the framework of the solar system, which is very important, of course, because if we have a theory which can reproduce the solar system, really we don't have an alternative theory. So okay, we take this approximation in which we take the scalar factor equal to 1 and constant. We avoid the temporal derivative, and finally we take empty. We take an space-time empty. So well, we of course, we introduce linear perturbation in the metric. We obtain a system of equation which is very easy with this approximation, and at the end of the day, we obtain the Bardeen potential. Besides, we can apply an expansion of our function in order to obtain some restriction in the context of the solar system. So in this case, the result should disappear, in which in this case it's complicated, is to demonstrate that this parameter has been contained between these values of here. But we want to study this without any approximation, because we believe that we could obtain a new phenomenology. So, well, I repeat a little the process. We introduce linear perturbation in the metric, and we introduce perturbation in the scalar field. So we have a system, a very big system of equation, which parameters are the Bardeen potentials, the perturbation around the scalar fields, and the density contrast. Well, really this is a very long algebraic play, so I think it's not necessary to solve here, because it's very long and really is a system of equations. And at the end of the day, we are trying to obtain an equation for the density contrast. But, like I said, this system of equations is very hard, it's very difficult, so it's very important to introduce a very well function, a function that in one part can reproduce the supernova data, and can reproduce, well, can fit into stabilities. So with this, I go with the conclusion. Well, modified gravity and in particular a non-local theory of gravity could answer some problems of general relativity, such as, for instance, the coincidence problem. The study of the theory with the inverse of the Lambertian is much easier when performed in the local representation. However, the local representation could be unstable since both representations are not exactly equivalent. So we should check the quality of solution about the equation of motion. Remember, this is very important. And in hope, the study of the local representation is useful in the framework of modified gravity, but we have to include two conditions in order to avoid possible goals. We can accommodate this theory in the solar system frame with the quasi-static approximation, and currently we are focusing on the theory of a scalar perturbation about the local representation without any approximation. And this is all. Thank you very much for your attention.
What it seems to me that you undo over a century of general relativity, the whole idea of a local field theory. Now you produce action at a distance, right? So why are you saying that this action at a distance is in some sense supplement to GR? Because if you have action at a distance, GR doesn't fit into it. It's in a sense. Your non-local theory would be the primary thing, and GR would be a correction to it.
Yes.
Would you agree?
Yes, I think.
So, then you're essentially saying, let's throw out general relativity.
Yes.
Okay.
Did it work? Does it describe compact binaries? Does it describe gravitational waves? Oh,
well, I don't know.
No, general relativity.
Well, you'll be too hard. Yeah, I mean, this thing is to come down from when you try to do some classical analysis. So, yeah.
But point, if you actually follow through effective field theory ideas, right, we assume, well, it's going to be non-localities because you have a Goldstone mode, which something like the Goldstone mode. You have massless particles, right?
Yes.
Gravitons. But it's more about QCD than anything else. And when you follow these things through, what happens is, yes, you end up with stuff which is logarithmic, which is definitely non-local in coordinate space, in phase space. When you transform back to coordinate space, they become local again. So there's no sense in which you can derive something which is non-local in coordinate space, right, from any sort of effective field theory approach to anything you vaguely to do with general relativity. That's my contention.
Yeah, we need to get stuff to just purify you.
We have to take another question.
Thank you, Smart, for your nice talk. Can you explain to me again, why do you have two scalar fields?
Why?
Well, yeah, because at the end you showed you have two gravitational perturbation, which is normal. But then you showed two scalar fields.
We are speaking about the last part,
yes.
Ah, the last
part? Yes.
Okay.
So why do you have two scalar?
Yes.
Yes. Well, maybe I misunderstood what you said.
Okay. Well, we have two scalar fields.
Yeah, that's.
Because when we go to the local frame, to the local representation, we have introduced two scalar fields.
Okay, so that's.
So, well, when we apply perturbation in this theory, we have to perturbate the two scalar fields and the method.
So, your theory at the end, when you go to the other frame, is GR plus two scalar fields. Is
exactly.
That?
There are no other questions. Let's thank Kishmet again.